Salt is one of the most important commodities in the world. And frankly, we wouldn't be where we are today as a race without good old salt. From cooking and food preservation to agriculture, skincare, road de-icing, and so on, salt is something we simply cannot do without. So, how is salt made? Let's walk through the process. The earliest history of salt making dates back to around 6000 BC, when people living in present-day Romania boiled spring water to extract salts. As civilizations came and went, salt became an important article of trade, transported by boats across the Mediterranean Sea and across the Sahara on camel caravans. You know, some of our ancestors even fought battles over salt. So it goes without saying that salt is one of the most essential things in the modern world. I mean, who could imagine a world without salt? Apart from making our food taste amazing, salt's used in healthcare, agriculture, and even religious rituals. With all the many uses of salt, it's interesting to know that around 300 million tons of salt are produced around the world annually. But of that jaw-dropping amount, only a fraction is used for human consumption. There are different types of salt, which all have other mining and production processes. The first we'll examine today is rock salt. This is not the actual salt we consume. Instead, it's the stuff you see being poured on the roads when it snows to prevent cars from slicking off the road or crashing into each other. This is known as gritting. The rock used for gritting roads is obtained from mines of ancient underground salt deposits. Have you ever noticed that as the temperature drops during winter, you see gritter trucks out spreading something that looks like grit on the road? They're spreading salt, but not the type we consume. And the purpose of spreading salt on the ground is to prevent the roads from becoming icy. Rock salt is obtained from those underground salt deposits. In the UK, for example, rock salt mines are located in Cleveland County, Antrim, and below the Cheshire town of Winsford. Some of the rock salt mines in the US are Grand Saline in Texas, the Michigan Basin, parts of the Appalachian Basin in Ohio, New York, and West Virginia. However, there are hundreds or even thousands of rock salt mines all over the world. The mines vary in depth, from 100 meters to a mile or more underground. Inside these mines are networks of tunnels and caverns formed as the rock salt is extracted. These tunnels make it easy for mining vehicles to move from one part of the mine to another. This also allows miners or other staff to move freely from the mine entrance to the working face. Because of how useful they are and the nature of the vehicles that move through them, these tunnels often have an unbelievably huge size and scale. Rock salt is usually mined using different techniques. The first is cut and blast mining, which involves cutting a slot at the base of the rock face using a machine called an undercutter, with a jib carrying a series of tungsten carbide picks. This part is the cut part of this technique. Next is the blast part of the technique. Using an electro-hydraulic rotary drill, the rock face is drilled with carefully sighted holes. These holes are then charged with explosives and detonated. One batch can yield up to 1,200 tons of broken rock salt. The rock blasted from the face is then crushed into smaller pieces about the size of a football using a secondary crusher. The crushed rock is then carried on a conveyor belt to the primary crusher, breaking it into smaller pieces. During this process, the rock is passed through a sieve to ensure it meets the standard size used to de-ice roads. Afterward, the rock salt is stored until it's needed for de-icing. The next technique for making rock salt is the continuous mining technique, which produces smaller lumps of rock than the cut and blast technique. The important machinery used in this technique is a boring machine, similar to a pneumatic drill used in digging up roads. The boring machine has a rotating head carrying tungsten carbide tips, which bores into rock, breaking it into lumps. The lumps are then transported directly to a crushing and screening plant, where they're crushed into the standard de-icing size and screened for defects. This technique usually doesn't involve pre-crushing the rock lumps by a feeder breaker. All the crushing is done at the crushing and screening plant. The last technique used for rock salt mining is the room and pillar mining technique. With this technique, miners must ensure that the mine is stable by leaving substantial pillars of salt to support the mine roof. The mine layout here is called room and pillar. It involves mine engineers using the principles of rock mechanics to calculate the optimum size of the pillars. This ensures the safety and stability of the mines as miners work them. Once the rock salt has been broken and crushed, it's treated with an anti-caking agent to prevent the pieces from coagulating. This allows the rock salt to be held in local storage depots until needed for the icy winters. Now that we know how rock salt is formed, let's examine a different type of salt. White salt, also known as table salt. The salt in your salt shaker is produced via a simple two-step process of extraction and refinement called solution mining and brine evaporation. The first step is solution mining, which involves extracting the salt by forcing water under pressure into a borehole drilled into an underground salt bed or dome. As the water hits the salt below, the salt dissolves, turning the water into brine. This also creates a cavern in the salt bed. Next, the brine is pumped back to the surface and transported to a purification plant. At the purification plant, impurities, including calcium and magnesium, are removed from the brine before it's sent to the next stage, brine evaporation. In hotter countries, the sun is sufficient to evaporate the brine. But in colder climates, brine evaporation is done by evaporating solution-mined brine in pressure vessels, a process known as vacuum evaporation. A typical vacuum plant comprises a series of closed cylindrical vessels, or effects. These vessels consist of some steam chambers, which contain several tubes. Water evaporates as the brine boils in the first vessel or effect, producing even more steam and causing salt crystals to grow. With the brine boiling and more steam evaporating, a thick salt slurry of brine and crystals is formed in the first vessel or effect. The salt slurry is fed to the second vessel and circulated through a second heat exchange unit that utilizes the exhaust steam from the first vessel to evaporate more moisture from the brine. This creates more salt crystals. Meanwhile, the pressure and boiling temperatures become successively lower through the evaporators. The final ones operate under a vacuum, allowing the brine to boil at much lower temperatures. This makes the whole process much more energy efficient. The slurry from the final vessel is then fed into a rotating centrifuge, which spins off more moisture. The result is an undried vacuum salt that's stored in bulk. This salt is usually for supply to the chemical industry. It's not fit for human consumption. To get salt that can be used in food and related industries, there must be even more dyeing. So, salt from the centrifuges is fed into fluid bed dryer coolers. These dryers are similar to hair dryers, and they remove as much moisture as possible from the salt. By the time the salt is properly dried, there should only be as low as 0.1% of moisture left in it, which comes from an anti-caking agent that some manufacturers choose to add to the salt. Finally, the salt is sieved and graded before being transferred into large storage hoppers for distribution. The safety standards for making salt are very high, as it can easily contain unwanted minerals or chemicals if not treated properly. This is especially true for table salt or otherwise consumable salt, which must pass all the health guidelines put in place by the FDA. So, now you know making salt is not as simple as getting water from the ocean and boiling it till all that's left is salt. Well, it was that simple for our ancestors, but today there are several complicated processes and machinery used in the making of salt that make it safer for consumption and more long-lasting and tasty. And with that, we've come to the end of today's video. Are there meals you prefer to eat with salt and some you don't like to add salt to? Leave a comment down below and don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to this channel for more content just like this.